back again. I don't know what day. I think it's Thursday. Somebody told me it's Thursday today, and I just about fell over. Can't believe it's Thursday already. God. Anyway, a lengthy conversation with numerous people yesterday, actually, including my friends in the north. And from what I gather, the camp is getting terrorized right now. Currently, as we sit here, there are native guys. Very, very skilled bush guys, was the quote. And they are absolutely terrified this moment. And this isn't actually in a guide territory either. I forget the absolute details, but I'm not really concerned. I'll find out later. But so they had a video camera, and obviously too terrified to go outside the door, stood just inside the door, out just in the doorway by the looks of it, and let the video camera record while these things were screaming. Thank God, it was broad daylight too, it's not nighttime. And the word is they are seeing these things daily. Excuse me. So, I don't know, I'm on the fence about going up. I mean, I'm going up north no matter what at the end of this month. And my contact, a friend of mine who I'm talking to, he can't get into where they are. He won't be there exactly physically where they are until September either. I haven't offered up to come up yet. We'll see. Because I have other commitments for me, a lot of work that I put into for my upcoming hunting season. Remember last spring I went up there and I dropped probably 300 pounds of salt and a dozen cameras all over the place. I want to see that. I got friends I want to meet up with. I have hunting. I have somebody I'm going to try to get a big elk with. I got a bunch of stuff that I really have to knock off. But at the same time, I have a plane lined up from a friend of mine up north too, who's willing to go fly right in there. So I don't know. We'll see. I was talking to Sarah about it last night. I don't know. My gut doesn't tell me it's too alarming, but then I'm starting to picture what would happen if I went up there. Is there a chance of the tagging thing going on? I don't know, maybe. Would I possibly create something that I don't want in my life by going up there intentionally? I don't know. But my guts will know. My true instincts will know. Every single decision I make in my life, I go with my instincts. And that is probably why I am where I am. No one controlling me, and I'm doing good. So, we'll see how it goes the next few days. They're going to be in touch more, keep me updated on what's going on up there. So anyways, getting back to what was sent to me. So they sent a... I guess they are in... within satellite, they must be using satellite internet to be able to contact each other, something. Because what they did was, I guess they had a video camera. They have other videos, apparently. But they had a video camera, and it looks as though they were just kind of sticking the camera out the door while these things are humming away. And I think they're not tech savvy enough to take the SD card out, probably, and download that clip and send it. So what they did was they flipped the screen on the video camera and held their phone on it and recorded it that way. So, I won't even bother showing you the video because there's nothing in the video. All it is broad daylight, fuzzy, the porch railing, that's it. There's nothing in the video to show you, all right? But there is the audio. The audio is the main thing right now. So, here is the audio. I don't know, I'll probably load this onto the video directly from my phone. I'll download this on the computer and play it that way, because I don't think doing it this way will be as clear, but we can try it. Hold on. Listen to this. One more time. And that's broad daylight. So they also said that he'll get me all the original soon enough, as soon as he can. But I don't know. We'll see if I'm gonna go up there or not. And I contacted somebody you guys all know, and I don't need you to hound anybody at all, but I contacted somebody you guys all know, and definitely that person showed a huge interest in going up. I don't know. For me, my incentive would be to talk to that whole crew and share with them what I know and to encourage them not to quit. But this does sound a little alarming, doesn't it? I mean, seeing them, quote, all the time, more than one, and broad daylight, they're doing this shit to these guys. What's up with that? That sounds a little on the alarming side, right? But nobody's disappeared, nobody's been harmed. But I don't know many of the details of what's going on yet, so we'll see. It's kind of funny, I was just thinking about this earlier. I was thinking, imagine if, I don't know how many people are listening to these videos that have given themselves the title of a researcher, and they, in their mind, are still stuck in that place where they think they need proof for the world. I'd imagine those people who are in that camp, they must be going absolutely apeshit hearing this one. Oh my God, I gotta get up there. I have to be the first one. I have to get it on video. I have to prove to the world, right? I don't know how many people have been on this page from the beginning, but you gotta admit, this group is so far beyond that now, it's ridiculous. Don't you agree? The thought of needing proof does not enter my mind in the slightest, feeblest way ever. We are way, way, way beyond that place, that quagmire. Imagine at this point of the game, after having listening to all the people who, we only have each other, that's all we got is the people. Imagine being at this stage of the game of all the brave people coming forward, making this group the most powerful one on the face of the planet when it comes to this topic, and that's a fact. And imagine actually being stuck, thinking you need proof for the world at this stage of the game. I do not envy anyone who is stuck there. That's for certain. But anyway, let's take a minute out here and I will play the audio recording again, downloaded. Here you go. I've got somebody from here coming fishing with me in a couple days. I think there's a whole shit pile of people trying to come fishing with me, but I guess the scamdemic is having a negative impact on a lot of people wanting to do that, so we'll see what comes. But I sincerely hope that as many people from here manage to make it out fishing with me. It'd be a lot more interesting for me to have guests that were on the same page with this topic to talk about while fishing all day than it would be strangers that don't know who I am or what we are about, right? But anyway, this is from the Owlman's sister. Should be interesting. Hi Steve, I hope this email finds you well. My name is blank, but I'll ask if you're going to read any of my emails to refer to me on your channel, please call me Rainbow Child. I'm the Owlman's sister. I'm writing to you because it's important to me to help human beings understand the people, and it seems I have indirectly become part of Edgar's story. All right. I call them the people, but the world knows them as Sasquatch, Bigfoot, or Yeti. I call them people because that's what they are. They are a humanoid branch of genealogy that we don't understand. Some of the things I'll go over with you in this email and how I've come to know them won't make much sense. And in fact, at times, I've struggled with this information myself. I wanted to reach out because it's very important to me to help people understand that these beings sharing our planet are not monsters. They're not animals, and they're not malevolent. They are not meant to be hunted nor dissected for research. I've come to know these people through a kindness, compassion, and connection I cannot understand nor explain. Secondly, my goal is to assist people who have had experiences with these beings. Let me take you back about 15 years ago when my brother, an active hiker and nature observer, was going out to some nearby river systems in our area. He found something interesting and perplexing to him on one of his excursions and decided to make a mold of what he found. I was in my early 20s and I remember him coming home exclaiming the exciting news that he found something, the source of which was a mystery to him. And it was a footprint, a very large human-like footprint. I'll tell you, Steve, I remember thinking to myself, if this is a person's footprint, this must be a giant. My brother has been a very well-respected animal breeder his entire adult life, breeding animals of all kinds with feathers, fur, and gills. He grew up on the banks of the water systems in our area, and he knew the rivers and lakes and creeks like the back of his hand. After realizing he couldn't ascertain origin of this footprint, nor why someone this size would be in the area he found the print, he reached out for assistance. But somehow this print hit him to his core, and I watched as this discovery changed my brother forever. Many, many years later, it was determined by experts that this print was of an unknown species. Fast forward a few years, and by this time, we know there is an unknown species of life running around the mountains, caves, and water systems. So naturally, my brother took a scientific approach and began to collect data of all kinds. During his research, he learned there are some humans, a biosensor or bioantenna, as I like to call us, who are able to consciously connect with the people. He had a friend who could do this, and they would go out on excursions to find different groups of these people. And his friend at the time would telekinetically reach out to connect. My brother explained what he was doing, but I was busy living my life until one day he asked me if I'd like to come out with him. Mind you, I've been hearing stories about Sasquatch for many years, and I'm open to things that can exist, but I might not be aware of, but it's a whole other story when you have a one-on-one experience yourself. Not having any experiences at this point, and was curious. I eagerly accepted, and my brother and his friend and myself went out. I immediately had an experience. I could see the people with my naked eye. I could hear them and feel their presence. From that day forward, my life has never been the same. Over the course of the next 10 years, I began to learn more and more about them. They've shared their consciousness with me, and I'm able to access memories. Let me read that sentence one more time. They've shared their consciousness with me, and I'm able to their access memories. So I meant probably I'm able to access their memories. I'm reaching out today not only because it's my personal mission to educate human beings about the existence of these people, but also, and most importantly, I have vowed to assist people who have had experiences to be able to psychologically and emotionally handle and process the experience. Good for you. Absolutely appreciate that. A few months back, my brother reached out and explained that he'd saw your episode about Edgar. I immediately started to download information. In real time, I was able to journey with Edgar and the being that he traveled with, and I could see every detail all at once. I was able to exactly explain to my brother what happened to Edgar, where he went, and what the side effects will be as a result of the situation. My brother took notes and sent you what we discussed. When it was determined, Edgar has been exposed to radiation. My brother called me and asked, how did you know that, as I told him, the illness Edgar was experiencing was due to the radiation he was exposed to during his journey. I explained to him, I knew that in the same way that I know that Edgar had been at every location on the globe all at once and beyond. He's been to every point in the known and unknown universe. And I could explain it all. I could actually recreate the situation from the moment Edgar stumbled on this being to the moment he was found. I can see it playing frame by frame in my mind like a movie. I can stop, I can play, fast forward, rewind, and pause. I can go into a picture in that movie and explore. I can see all of this information as I described this to my brother, and he provided it to you. At the time of our conversation, I had no known details of awareness of Edgar's situation. This is absolutely mind-blowing, interesting. I know Edgar's scared, I know he's confused, and more importantly, the lack of support from the people around you that begin to think you're crazy after you start talking about your experiences can be devastating. I know these things because I've been through it personally and watched so many others as they try to make sense of what they have experienced. These situations can cause us to lose very important people in our lives. They can cause us our health and our sanity. I've seen Edgar's experience and the journey frame by frame. Once you have an experience, you begin to know there are things in this world beyond which we understand that do exist. Truths that are ever present, though we don't see them. Please feel free to share this information with your subscribers and also, but also with Edgar. Best regards, Jennifer. Okay, Jennifer, that's almost a bit of a tease, isn't it? You can see every single page, the picture, the details, and you're not sharing it with me. So, maybe if you would, if you got the time and you could be so generous, it would be to try to put into words as best you can exactly what you feel that journey was, how it went about, where he went, and help us put it together. Because what I understand, you just gave us a vague description of how you can see the whole story and how it played out by picture, and explore it. I want to hear what you explored. I want to hear what you saw, what you felt, what you know from the exploration. I want to know what you know in intimate detail about what possibly happened to him. If you would, that would be very generous of you. Sounds interesting to me. And obviously there's going to be a whole pile of people out there that are going to go, yeah, right. But if I caution all people with that attitude, if that's the attitude you're going to carry yourself through this lifetime, you're going to be stuck in the same place that how many generations have been stuck going nowhere and doing what that little 1% wants you to do. Being a good little kitten, right? I'm not going to be a good little kitten. I'm going to be a bad cat. Actually, I'm going to be the bad dog. Thanks so much. And email us back some more, please. Now here's one with a photo. It's titled, huh? This is new as well. Hi Steve, please don't use my name. I've watched your channel a few years now. I do rather worry I have attracted whatever as I turn off any weird stuff mostly now, whether thinking or viewing. I'm almost 65, grew up in the country of central BC town and spent 4.5 years in a log cabin there. I also spent 12 years in the Shuswap. I have stories related to me, both places. I lived in central Alberta for 32 years now. You should have a viewer mentioned Buck Lake on your last show. Myself and my family have had a few experiences while hunting. We had a young moose follow us that hunt, but I don't believe it explained the creep show that followed us right to the van. I think it wanted my girls. It stopped and we stopped no further than 25 yards paralleling us. We're on an unused oil road. I had a very powerful mag light and another smaller mag light. No green or yellow eyes. Zero. And I could hear it drop from a tree, clearly like a big black bear or cougar thump. When we got to the van, we heard it right there in the spruce. I told the girls, just get in and start it, and I'll unload guns. That is the story. Another story at the same place was after I had an unsuccessful hunt and never left my usual half a liver offering. I was just back to the truck, to the same parking spot. The sound I heard was unearthly, like a woman from a lunatic asylum, but at least five times longer and louder than any person or elk could muster, with a distinct whoop at the end. And I oddly felt the air vibrate, and it seemed to feel the earth vibrate as if lightning struck. No interest of learning more, just into the truck. My windows were frosted on my old truck, and I said out loud, don't fail me now. Vroom. I cannot get in fast enough, as it was after last shooting light. I was actually terrified and had goosebumps. I'll just say Buck Lake isn't far, but Sasquatch, or what it is, are way east of it. I still hunt the area and have other odd things in that area, camping, and had three knocks replied to in the spring after moose and elk and deer should have shed. There's something though. A track between my garage and old truck in central Alberta. Not the first or last, and it creeps me out. Now, whether I'm sleepwalking in minus 30 or have a creep barefoot with a dog, or it is something odd, not sure what. Here's the track on top of our own track. Our own last tracks of the evening. My old dog passed before this. It stood on ice long enough to form a pressure ridge, or it warmed in the night and then dropped back to minus 30. So, huh? Not saying. Here it is. Don't use my name. It's an odd one. I don't know if this will pick it up or not. We'll try it out. I think it's going to be easy for me to do it that way. Now, check that. There's a photo included. Hope that's focusing. I don't think there's any claws in that. Jumbled up toes in there for sure. Confusing track for me to look at anyway. And there you go, another member of the Club of No Return. I wonder what there's different, there's the types of howls that we just heard in the recording from up north. And then there's the one that Erga describes as a woman getting murdered. Extremely loud, vibrates your body in the ground, it scares the living shit out of you. I wonder what that one is all about. I mean, there's other ways you can scare a human away besides that, going to that extreme, right? Another one, and another one, and another one. This one. It's a short one. Steve, I do feel alone in northern Wisconsin. Didn't believe shit, honestly, till me and my wife saw an effing dogman 6 years ago. And my digging for truth eventually found you. Tried talking to people in our area, but they think I'm crazy, even though I told them she was there and saw it too. That's it. This must be, I think this is a screenshot of a comment. Kitty Nightingale, you do feel alone. All right, well, you know what? I don't know how I can help. I can help by saying you're not alone if you just look at how many people are here. There's so many people here in the same boat as you. It's ridiculous. You're far from alone. You're just surrounded by a handful of scared people, that's all. And like I said, for a quick reminder on how to bring this topic up in your neighborhood, at work, your workplace, or whatever, you look people square in the eye, someone who you feel may be likely to have known something, and you just say, hey, have you ever seen anything weird in the woods around here or such and such place, like something really odd or heard something really weird or seen some weird footprints or something? It's a very innocent, neutral way to deliver it. And then you can see their honest reaction if they say, no, what do you mean? I don't know, I just saw something one time, no big deal. You shrug it off and you exit that exchange right away when you realize they're not game, they don't know shit. It's safe, right? Or somebody's going to pause and I'm going to look at you to see if you're dead serious. And there we go. They're going to assess you to see if you're safe. And then they're going to probably go, yeah, I saw something real weird. What did you see? And then it happens. And then people come forward and they share. So try that, all right? Instead of just bursting into the local small town coffee shop and whoever's sitting there saying, hey, everybody, guess what I just saw? All right? That's not a good way to do it. I'm not saying you did it that way, but it's not a good way to do it. All right. Hi, Steve. Please read this because I have a real warning for people who have had what they believe is a good relationship with forest people. They do not function on the same emotions that we do. They don't process and act in the same things we do. Please be understanding and realize that they are not the same as you. I had a rough experience with people when I was young. Then my parents and I moved out into the Pacific Northwest rainforest. This sounds familiar. I was about 7 and was enjoying my woodland solitude, or just a lack of bullying that I endured before we relocated. I was innocent and very hungry for social interaction. My first experience was when I was playing with my rope swing by myself at the edge of the forest. I had a sense of being watched, but was feeling like maybe I could feel a potential friend nearby. I sent a share telling you how one day I had hit my head on the fir tree hard enough that the thunk of my skull could be heard. I complained loudly, sat there recovering. I had urge to look to my left up the small canyon and saw a juvenile peeking out from behind a tree. I played peekaboo and laughed, and then Dad hollered so loud that I was both scared and angry. I turned and yelled that we were just playing. I then threw my chest out and did my best scared and angry kitten yell back at him. I think they viewed me with some humor and curiosity from then on, from 7 years old to 14 years old. My parents were cool with me hiking for 8 to 10 hours a day because I had been trained in direction and survival. I was homeschooled and a joyful person, only child. My sixth sense became such a part of me that I thought it was normal. In order to keep this email focused, I'm going to skip all the interactions with my forest people. We did have an understanding that I belonged there too, and I would stand up for it. The warning that I wanted to give is that I didn't understand their feelings. They had seen me abused by my parents and sometimes growled at them. I had a couple of times when I was shown compassion and support. I didn't discourage them. I'd go crying into the woods after being beaten by my parents, and they would make comforting sounds back. Then my parents caught on that there was something going on around us and told me that I could no longer go hiking in the woods. My life, they must have known, because they told me that I could have one more time in the woods to say goodbye to my friends. This is the most heartbreaking thing I could ever try to express to anyone. I cried and tried to explain, but just broke down on the forest floor crying. Finally, I walked back to my house heartbroken and sobbing uncontrollably. Not much time went by before I started seeing glimpses of them watching me from the forest. Also, they made themselves much more aware to me by cruising by my sliding glass door, sitting in the large fir tree outside my bedroom, and even when I moved to the second floor to sleep, they were there outside my window. I didn't realize how much they had involved themselves in my welfare. I was very nearly considered one of their clan, and I ended up leaving home at 15 years old. There might be a large display of "we own and protect her." All hell was going to break out. One of them even came in our front door, unlocked, and seeked me out one night while I was crying uncontrollably. He could hear me from outside my upstairs window. The one I was hiding from came upstairs and sat near where I was hiding and then just left. I asked my parents if it was them. They became afraid and said they would lock the doors. I left there because I didn't know how to handle an emotional situation that I had helped to create. This is so involved and it would be too long. I do wonder if I went back there if they would remember me. All right. I don't think I read that one on here, and that's definitely a different flavor, isn't it? Definitely a different flavor. I honestly can't say if that's a true story or not myself, right? Take from what you will or leave it, right? What I am thinking about right now, my first thought is, just for the flavor of how I've been going today, is I have a one single easy, hopefully easy question I want to ask the Owlman, the Owlman's sister, possibly this lady, and anyone else who claims to be communicating smoothly and understanding smoothly with these people. One big question I'm sure the audience will agree on is this. If you could please tell us why they go out of their way to kill our canine family members. I want to know why. All right? I want to know why they insist on tearing them in half, throwing them against the door dead on the porch, ripping their heads off, grabbing them by the neck in the box of a truck and squeezing and breaking their necks and killing them. All right? Because these canines are not going out of the way to harm them. They're not doing anything to them. They're part of our families and they're getting annihilated by them intentionally, unprovoked. So if what I think there's a numerous people out there who claim to be communicating smoothly with these people, please put it to rest for us once and for all and give us a smooth, confident answer to why they are killing our family member canines. That's what I want to know. That'll help me with a big part of my puzzle, for my puzzle, okay? That's a question I've been asking for a long time, actually, is why? Why do dogs not like them? Okay? Please. I would be very appreciative of that being answered. And we can also move forward with even more. Now, see if I can squeeze one more in here and then I gotta get moving. What's this one? This is titled Beaver, Utah, possible Bigfoot encounter. Utah? Probably. Thought about this for a while, and I thought I would share it. My dad and I were up in the Tushar Mountains near Beaver, Utah, which is my hometown. We're going into a relatively secluded area to put fresh bait on a site we had for the bear hunt. Partway through the hike, it began to rain and thunder. However, instead of going back, we decided to tough it out and finish the job. As you get close to where the bait site is, you have to walk a bit up a hill, at the base of which is a small meadow. My dad is ahead of me, starting up the hill, and I was standing in the meadow preparing to follow, when a rock about the size of a volleyball came flying out of the trees in midair, then hit the ground between me and my dad and rolled into the bushes. I shouted out to him, "Hey, something just threw a rock at me." He didn't hear me though, as he was too far ahead and the sound of the rain and the thunder made it hard to hear. I hurried to catch up to him. Luckily, I was carrying a .308 Mauser rifle for self-protection, but I still felt we needed to leave. When I caught up to him, I asked if there was anyone else in the area, to which he replied, "No, I doubt it." I told him about the rock, but he didn't have much to say right then, preferring to focus on getting to bait site restocked. Once that was done, we began to hike the 2 miles or so back to the truck. Nothing else of note occurred. I asked him later what he thought it was and responded that he had no idea and it was very unusual. The rock was way too big to have been thrown by a person, unless that person were Andre the Giant. Plus, the rock was airborne when it hit the ground, so I doubt it had come loose on the hill from the rain. I guess I can't say for sure it was an encounter with the Sasquatch, but I really don't know what else could have hurled a rock that size, high, and length. It should also be noted that the exact place where we were in was not close to any road or ATV trail, so I doubt it was someone messing with us. I also had heard rumors of people seeing these entities in that general area before, but usually just chalked it up to campers from the city who are a bit too superstitious. Looks like maybe I was wrong. Feel free to use my story, though omit my name, as I come from a small town where everyone knows everyone. I enjoyed your channel greatly. It's kept me company through my many evenings. Sincerely, your friend from Southern Utah. Okay, man, you know what it was. You know what I'm gonna say, you know, oh man. Had a little bit of an interruption there. What was I saying? Sorry. Rocks coming out flying out of the tree. What I would like to know is possibly, if you noticed if that rock was a round washed out river rock. That's another chunk of my puzzle I'm curious about. Because we're having way too many people saying that rocks are coming flying at them and they weren't from the area. And there was no water, no river system or anything, but they were washed out, rounded off river rock, big ones. That is very, very, very interesting to me. I am absolutely curious of how that's being pulled off. All right? You know what it was. You emailed us, you know what it was. Anyway, I gotta carry on. I'll be back shortly. And keep emailing me your stuff in.